Hello friends, welcome to Knowledge India once again. In today's tutorial, we are going to talk about S3 Simple Storage Service, which is an object-based storage. It is really cheap, service given by AWS. And the way you should understand S3 is that do not confuse it with the file system, right? You should not be, thinking of mounting it to a server and then trying to write files to it. It is not like EBS. So there's another tutorial where I have explained what S3, EBS, and EFS are and what are the fundamental differences between them. Today in this tutorial, we are going to get into S3 and we'll go ahead, create a bucket, and we'll try to see different properties of it so that we are clear. We'll also go ahead and try to configure CLI quickly and run a command with that. And list basically S3 related stuff. So let's get started. So as you saw on the previous screen at the top, I was there in the Oregon region. I clicked on S3 and you can see at the top, it became global, right? The reason for this is that from the UI perspective, all your buckets are shown at one place. That's why at the top you see as global. Don't get confused, S3 is not a global service. S3 is a regional level service, because when you go ahead and create a bucket, you are asked to choose region, and you'll have to choose one of the regions and your bucket will get created in that particular region. Now it is important to understand that your bucket name should be unique. And when we say unique, it should be unique in whole Amazon ecosystem. That means not only within your region and not only within your AWS account, it should be unique within whole Amazon. That means if somebody has taken a bucket name called Amazon, you cannot go ahead and create it, right? Of course, you'll get error. So there are a few more restrictions, like it should be, some 63 characters, and smallest can be 3 characters. You can check all of that. I'm not going to spend time on that. The important thing is, so you should go ahead and choose a unique name. So let's go ahead and try our name. And I would like to create it in, let's say, US standard I'll do. So US standard is nothing but North Virginia. Rest all names you see as their original one. Recently they have, they got the new S3 interface, new S3 UI. And if you are using there, the Montreal is actually Canada Central, and US standard is North Virginia. So in the newer S3 UI, you have everything, all the region names are standard. What you see, in the outside place, or here when you click at the region, whatever you see, those names are displayed. Anyway, I'll go ahead and create it in the North Virginia region. Let me try. Do we have this name? All right. So we have this name available. You can go ahead and check, and we got it. Our bucket is created. You can see on the right hand side the way different details related to it, and we'll go ahead and try to understand it one by one. So first thing is when it is created, and bucket name, and who is the owner. The owner is like with my account. That's why you see this particular thing. Next is permissions. So who all are allowed to basically read, write, or upload data to this particular bucket. So by default, I am there. If I want, I can add more permissions as well, where I can go ahead and give it to everyone, or to any authenticated AWS user. Anybody who is authenticated will be able to do, or for log purpose or things like that. So if I want to give, I can go ahead and choose one of these things. Another important thing is bucket policy. Now, bucket policy is something which I can define at this bucket level, and it will be applicable in that bucket, inside that bucket fully. So you will actually specify, and the way it is, if you have seen the earlier tutorial for IAM, the way we generate IAM policy, in a similar way you have policy generator here as well, which you can use to generate the bucket policy. All right, so I've come here to the policy generator, and let us choose here, we want to create an S3 bucket policy. The important difference here between the IAM policy generator and this one is, here you have got one more additional section called principle. So effect, service, action, and resource was there in the IAM policy as well, but here you have got one more thing called principle. So in principle, you can actually go ahead and give value of a particular user, right? So for example, if I want to allow that on this particular bucket knowledgeindia.in, I want to allow people, or I want to allow a user from some other AWS account to be able to come and do certain activities, I can put that particular user's ARN in the principal section here. And I will say within S3, you'll be able to do, let's say, put object. I want to allow that guy to come and put objects, you know, in this particular put object. So I want to allow put object, and whether I want to allow, you know, on this particular bucket, inside this bucket, or inside this bucket within a folder, I can specify that complete thing, that S3 buckets URL here. So when I do that, and how to write ARN, let us just, you know, check that in case you are not knowing already. If you just Google AWS ARN, you'll be able to get that. So here is the format. So I'll just go ahead and write S3 so that you are clear. So here is how you write S3, right? Okay, let me pick this up. I'll go ahead and put it here. Now in this, if you see in the start, ARN, AWS, S3, and after that two sections are blank, basically nothing is there. So that is your region and the account number. The first one is region and the account number, but because S3 bucket names are totally unique, we leave it blank. If you are writing something else for some other resource, you will actually be putting the region code and the 12-digit account number. Remember, 12-digit account number without any hyphens, and the region code, the standard region code, right? So if in whichever region your particular resource is, that particular region code you'll have to put. Many of the learners, they do this mistake that whenever region is asked, they write the human friendly name like North Virginia, Oregon. No, guys, you'll have to put its code. For example, for North Virginia, it is US East 1, US hyphen East hyphen 1. So you'll have to put that respective code for the region. But in case of S3, the code, region code and account number are not required. So that we'll just leave blank. And after that, we write the bucket name. So we'll go here, and here we will write our bucket name. .in. And then if we want to, you know, write or apply it for a particular folder or for a particular object, we can write its name, or we can even put star. So we are saying everything inside this particular bucket, this guy would be able to do. So he'll be able to put object anywhere inside this. And we can put that particular user's full username in the ARN format here. And after that, when you put add statement, you will have the policy ready, and you can copy and paste the policy here, right? So you can do that. And once you apply that, then this particular bucket will have, you know, that user from the other AWS account will have access to this particular bucket. An important thing to understand, and I'm hoping that you have seen IAM tutorial already. The IAM policies will apply to users within one account, right? So maybe within my account, I might have three users, user 1, 2, 3, and I want to allow user 1 to have access to 2, 3 buckets, user 2 to have access to 2, 3 buckets. That part I will achieve via IAM policies. But in case I want to give cross account access, I want to allow access on one of these buckets to somebody who is not part of this account, who is not part of this AWS account, then I come to bucket policy and I'll add the permissions or policies. All right, moving next is your static website hosting. Now this is a great feature. If you want, you can host a complete static website just out of S3. And when I say static website, you should understand there should not be any server-side processing pages. For example, PHP, JSP, or ASPX pages, those would not work. But your complete static website, things are like your HTML pages, JPG, JS, CSS files, right? Your audio, video, everything can be served just from here. All you have to do is just come here, say enable website hosting, give a page name, which will be your, you know, like your default page, or basically the control goes to this particular page if person is not writing anything. And you can just go ahead and simply say save. Once you do this, this particular URL will be active, and if you open this URL, the website will work. All right, so I just uploaded an index.html file. It just simply says hello guys, right? So let me go ahead and go to properties once again, and I will try to open the URL. which we saw. Here is the URL. Let's try to, okay, just copy it. Let me bring it here so that you can see. So we get error. Why? Because this particular object which we are trying to access, that object is actually private still, right? So nobody else can access it. If you go ahead and look at its properties, nobody other than me can access it. So I'll go ahead and just make this object as public. All right. And then we go to this URL again and we try to access and we are able to access it. All right. So what you need to do is, if you want to host a complete static website, you need to just come here and within your bucket, create folders accordingly. Things like all your HTML pages, you create folders like images, CSS, JavaScript, put everything there. And after that, just enable static website hosting and it all just works. All right. Next is your logging. You can go ahead and enable logging on your website, on your S3 bucket. Once you do that, all the access of objects, once it happens, whenever any object is accessed, it will be written or it will get recorded, and it will be written to a bucket wherever you say. For example, I can enable this thing and I can choose one of the buckets, and that I can give a folder name and all logs will get, will get delivered there. Later on, I can use this logs for auditing purposes and I can find out when which object was accessed. Events. Now, events is a great stuff. You can go ahead and basically create, that whenever any particular action happens on your S3 bucket, an event should get fired. And because of that event, what should happen, that also you can specify. For example, you can, give a name, let's say on create event, you go ahead and say on the creation, whenever somebody comes and puts a new object, right, that time, you want to, whether it is in a particular folder or within the bucket anywhere, you can specify that in the prefix and any specific extension you can specify. But if this thing happens, what do you want to do? You can go ahead and probably send a notification to an SNS or an SNS topic. Whoever has subscribed to that SNS topic will then get an email notification. You can also put a message inside an SQS queue, which another process could be polling that queue, and it can just retrieve that message and process it. Or you can also go ahead and just invoke a Lambda function. Maybe that Lambda function will pick up this particular image and it will go ahead and create a thumbnail out of it, right? So you can do any of this. And once you set this up, you just let it roll. And I mean, you need not do any manual intervention. Anytime a new object gets created, any of these actions would happen. So you don't have to worry about it. All right, next is your versioning. Versioning is great. Once you enable versioning, versioning is very simple. Once you enable versioning, if different files of the same name are being put in the bucket, all of them would be maintained. For example, if I have a file today called abc.doc, and after 2 days, I upload another file with the same name abc.doc, then the previous file is not overwritten. Rather, both the versions of the files are maintained, right? That's great. Also, in case I go ahead and just delete a file, it is not a real delete. It is just a marker which gets created. If I want, I can go ahead and just remove that marker and my file would be available again. So if you want, you can enable versioning. The only thing to remember, once you enable versioning, you cannot suspend it. You cannot remove it. You can suspend it, but you cannot remove it. So next item here is lifecycle. Now, this is a really, really good feature. What is lifecycle? So now, as you know, I've not covered this already, but let me show you this first of all. For any object, there are different storage classes within S3. What are the storage classes? The storage classes are designed so that based on different types of need, you can choose a storage class, and different storage classes have different pricing actually. Now, if you go ahead and look at the details, you can see by default, when you upload something, it is gonna be there in the standard class, right? Standard storage class. You also have two more classes. Let us understand what's the difference between them. So the standard storage class gives you 11 lines of durability, right? plus 4 or 5 nines of availability, right? I mean, I don't remember numbers, so we can just check that. But now infrequent access class, standard infrequent access, also gives you same 11 nines of durability, but when it comes to availability also it is same, but the per GB storage cost is lesser than that of standard, right? Per GB storage cost is lesser, but there's an additional clause. When you try to retrieve data, there is an additional fee there, right? That's why the type of the files which you don't access very frequently, those files you can keep here. Let me take an example. If you are hosting your website and you are putting all the static assets of your website like images, JavaScript, CSS files, these files you are going to be accessing a lot, right? Very frequently. Whenever your pages are getting loaded, they'll get downloaded. So for such things, a standard class is best. But for the second scenario, let's say you have your database files, you are taking backups, right? Backups of your on-premises databases or any backup, and you are keeping these backup files also on S3. Now you are not going to use these or download these backup files or access these backup files very frequently. Only once in a while for your testing or when something goes wrong, you'll try to download those files. For such things, the standard infrequent access class is very good, right? And the last one is reduced redundancy. So the way S3 works is when we create a bucket. So I created this bucket in North Virginia and I have uploaded an object called index.html. Automatically S3 will be replicating this object into multiple availability zones within that region. So normally in case of standard and standard infrequent access, the object will be replicated into 3 availability zones automatically. You would have seen I did not choose any availability zone while choosing the or while creating the bucket. I just gave the region. That's it, right? Within that region, automatically this object is replicated or multiple copies of this object is maintained so that data loss does not happen. Now, in case of standard and standard infrequent access, the object gets copied into 3 different availability zones. Whereas in case of reduced redundancy class, it gets copied only to 2 availability zones. That's why the durability is a bit lesser than that of standard, but the cost here is also less. So what type of object should we keep in reduced redundancy storage? The objects which are reproducible, right? Meaning if there is a base copy of image, right? An original image is there and you are creating thumbnails of that. You may choose to keep thumbnails in the reduced redundancy storage because just in case it gets lost, you always have a mechanism to generate it again. Now, this does not mean that it gets lost very frequently. 4 or 5 nines of durability is also is very good. So, but it gives you a really cheaper cost. So these are three different types of storage classes. Now, coming back to our bucket and the lifecycle policy, now it will make more sense when we'll go to lifecycle policy. Now, you understood that standard class costs maximum and then as you move to other classes, the cost is lesser. So when you come to lifecycle policy, you can come here and say add rule, and you can say whether you want to allow that rule to the whole bucket or within a folder to that. What are the rules? You can go ahead and define rules like transition to standard infrequent after 30 days and then send it to Glacier after 60 days and then permanently delete after some number of days. So if you see the diagram which got created, as soon as a file will come into S3, first it will come into standard class. Then automatically once 30 days cross, you know, gets over for that particular file, it moves to the standard infrequent access. And then after 60 days, it moves to Glacier. Glacier is an archival service. And after 425 days, it would be deleted. Now, all these days which you see mentioned here on the screen are from the creation date. Okay. Important part to understand here, as the file is moving from one storage class to other storage class, from standard to IA, then from IA to Glacier, and then finally getting deleted, as it is moving from one class to another, the storage cost is getting reduced, right? Because Glacier is cheaper than IA. IA is cheaper than standard, right? So it is getting, as it moves from left to right, the price is getting reduced, and hence it is saving money for you without any manual intervention. So you can go ahead and make use of this particular, this particular lifecycle policy. And I would also request you to go ahead and read more so that you understand some of the typical restrictions which are there while you apply this. All right. Next is cross-region replication. Now, cross-region replication, as I told you, a bucket's scope is there within a region. Sometimes people want to keep their files in two different geographies altogether, right? Let's say you have your files in Mumbai region. You also want to keep a copy of that in Oregon region, just to make sure that if something happens to one particular region, your files are still safe. So what you can do is you can come here and enable versioning. When you enable versioning, before enabling versioning, it's mandatory to, you can come and enable here cross-region replication, but before enabling cross-region replication, it's mandatory that you enable versioning. Only after that, you can come and enable cross-region replication. And it's very simple. Let me just do this. I'll just enable versioning. So once you enable, you cannot disable. I mean, you cannot completely remove it. That's what it said. You can suspend it though. So after enabling versioning, you can see that you have option to enable cross-region replication. What you do is you come here and you choose that this is my source bucket and my objects will need to be created in some other region. You can go ahead and choose the region, some other region, whichever you want. And in that you can choose a bucket. Currently, I don't have a bucket, but you can choose that and you can even choose the storage class there and then just with next set of few clicks, you just set this up. And then any file I put in knowledgeindia.in, it will get replicated to the other bucket automatically. So this is a great feature. You can go ahead and do that. Now, important point to remember here, when data goes from one region to another, it travels, public network and you pay for it. Data out charges would be applicable. If you want to understand about the data out charges, look at the live session which I did, which talks about pricing and billing, like 1-2 weeks back. You can find that video on the channel. Please go ahead and look at it. Next are your tags. So I've also talked about cost allocation tags already. You can go ahead and add tags here. And for example, this particular bucket belongs to environment one. I can come here and add tag like, environment, and I can put like environment one, or I can put dev in the same way for the other buckets as well. And then all the cost factors which get associated with this particular bucket, or because of which some money is being spent, everything gets recorded in the detailed billing file. And against that, this particular tag value would come. So that's a great feature. You can do that. Okay, next is your requester pays. Now, before we understand requester pays, we will have to understand that what are the different factors based on which your S3 billing happens. So first and most important factor, of course, is amount of data which you store. So amount of data which you store, you pay for that. And there is no minimum amount of data which you need to store, right? The amount of GB which you store for that thing based on the class which you have chosen, you pay for it. Okay, the second factor is the amount of data out which happens from your bucket. The data out charges you'll have to pay. Third is the amount of requests which are happening in S3. What are the requests? Requests are like put an object, get an object, delete an object, list how many objects are there. So all these are requests. So either you do from UI or you do via CLI, you are going to basically, you are going to be charged for this. Now there are charges for this. You can always look at just S3 pricing and you will understand in every region there is a different charge. Now normally if I own this bucket knowledgeindia.in, I will be paying for all these three things. But if I enable this requester pays option, what would happen is for all the data out charges and the request charges would be paid by any particular AWS account which tries to copy the content from my bucket. Though I will still have to pay for the storage charges, the amount of data which I keep. But if let's say account two, some other AWS account, account two tries to copy the data from my knowledgeindia.in.bucket, the data out charges and the request charges that put get object and all of that, that the account two will be paying. So you can go ahead and enable it. If you have a content for which others are ready to pay, you can go ahead and enable that. Transfer acceleration. Now this is a great feature. And in order to understand this, you'll have to visualize things a bit. Let's say that you are based out of Bangalore, India, right? And you have a bucket in, Tokyo, Japan. Now, if you try to upload some data from Bangalore to this particular bucket, which is there in Tokyo, Japan, directly, your data would travel from Bangalore to Tokyo over the public network. Instead of that, if you enable this particular transfer acceleration option, you get a new endpoint. Oh, so there is a problem. I had the bucket, you know, with this dot. So any otherwise, you will just get a URL here. So if you use that particular endpoint, the endpoint which you get here after enabling, if you use that and try to upload your data from Bangalore, what would happen is it will search one of the nearest edge locations, CloudFront edge locations, which is our CDN service, right? So it will search for one of the nearest edge locations and it will route the traffic via that. So let's say from Bangalore, maybe the nearest edge location could be Chennai. So from Bangalore to Chennai, only your traffic travels over the public network. From Chennai, it enters the Amazon network. And then from Chennai to Tokyo, it goes via Amazon network. In this way, you will get 200 to 300% better speed compared to the normal upload. So you can go ahead and use transfer acceleration. There's a charge for it, but only when you actually get transfer acceleration, then only you pay for it. Last is your storage management. This is there in the new console, not available here. So I'm leaving it for now. Let us go inside and see one, two more things. So if you select this, look at its properties, the object properties. So we looked at the details. You can also, enable server-side encryption if you want, and just say save, and it will encrypt that. I made this particular thing public. That's why you see that there is an entry added with everyone, and it is permission is allowed to open or download. Metadata, any metadata which you want, you can add with this particular object. If you want, you can add more metadata. There are a few, pre-built things which you can go ahead and choose. And tags are also available at per object level. Also you can add tags, but that is available in the new console. So these are the different things related to S3. I just wanted to get started with S3 because we did not do a video on S3 till now. So you understand that so what is the way? How do you upload files or download files from S3? It is all via AWS functions, via AWS API. So if you are, because we did from GUI, so we were able to upload from here. If you are doing via CLI, then you will go ahead and call put object or get object commands, and you will actually do things. So let us do one thing quickly. We'll go ahead and we'll try to configure and run one to S3 commands. And let me just do one thing. I'll go ahead and create a user, an IAM user, so that we can take the keys and configure here. So I'm creating a user called KI. I'm giving it programmatic access so that I can get access key, and I'll give it policy related to S3. All right, so I'll give it S3 full access, next, and we'll say create user. So you can see that we have access key and secret key created. We'll go ahead and try to run AWS configure so that we can put access key and secret key. We'll copy this and we'll put it here. And then we want secret key. We'll copy this and we'll put it here. And default region, we can leave this, and this we can give JSON. If we do S3 ls, we are able to see buckets. Right, all the buckets we are able to see. So if you see here, we had two buckets, both the buckets we are able to see. So in this way, you can go ahead and do things. You can run more commands. You can also go ahead and I'll be doing a different tutorial altogether on more CLI, but I just wanted to show you that how you can configure quickly and you can do things. In this case, I have given US East 1 because it is S3. In case of S3, when you are operating at the top level, you will be able to run LS by giving any region. Okay, it is irrespective. So if I'm giving US East 1 or I give US West 2, I'll be able to do this. But for all the services where those are very region specific, or when we start running, when those are region specific, basically you need to give the region code properly. So we will end this video here, and more tutorials are coming. I hope you like this thing. Guys, I request you that if you are able to understand and if you are getting benefited, please go ahead and share these videos with your friends on Facebook, LinkedIn, wherever you want. You have our blog up. You can go ahead and look at it. I'm also starting to run few quizzes there, so you can just subscribe to our Twitter and Facebook, and when you see those quizzes, please reply to that, and of course answer also would be given. The blog's URL is given below. Please go ahead and subscribe to it. Thank you. Bye bye.